Shalom everyone, Shavua Tov, Chodesh Tov, and we are in Parashat Achrei Mot Kedoshim. It's two parashot together that are always connected somehow to the month of Iyar, the month of Taurus. So what's in it for us and how and what do we extract out of it? Now Parashat Achrei Mot is a very special parasha since it is being read, all of it, on Yom Kippur. What's the connection between Yom Kippur and this week? It's like this week we're not celebrating any Yom Kippur like thing. So what is so special about this this parasha? And another thing, which when it says by the first verse of the parasha, it's like totally disconnected from the whole Yom Kippur thing because it says, "Vaydaber Hashem el Moshe achrei mot shnei bnei Aharon." And God spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, and as they approach in front of God, and they died. And then the parasha starts on verse 2. We are talking about chapter 16 in the book of Leviticus. So it is said very clearly. Okay, we have an alarm. We'll have to take a break. Okay, that was okay. So we can continue. Okay. So it appears very clearly in the Zohar when it says, "Amad Rabbi Elazar." Rabbi Elazar said, "Mikra ze yesh litbonen bo." This verse we have to contemplate on it. Why? Nirashu miyutar. It looks like it's redundant. We don't need it. We already read in Parashat Shmini about the death of the two sons of Aaron. So why do I need to add over here the mentioning that the death of the two sons of Aaron? That's what Rabbi Elazar says. And then the second verse, verse 2 in chapter 16 in Leviticus, it says, and God spoke to Moses, talked to Aaron, your brother. And then the parasha is starting. So what do we need that verse for? However, I'm reading from the Zohar. B'sha'a shenatan ha-kadosh baruch ha-ektor et ha-samim la'aron. When the Creator gave the incense to Aaron, Ratzah shalo yishtamesh ba'ish acher b'chayav. He gave it just for Aaron and that nobody else would use it all his life. What's the reason? What? Ma'atam. Lefi sha'aron yirba shalom ba'olam. We learned that Aaron became the high priest, the first Kohen, because he was the person that was bringing peace to everywhere possible. Couldn't stand the idea that two people do not talk to each other. Neighbors, friends, brothers, a husband and wife, parent and child, stuff like this. He would go around and always find people that don't like each other and always bring peace and make them united, which is very, very, very powerful and very important. Now, that made Aaron to become naturally the first Kohen. That energy of the Kohen is the energy that runs in the family. So even today, people called Kohen, the ones who are really direct descendants of Aaron, the high priest, and with all the regulations, they can give the blessing, the priestly blessing of Aaron, the high priest. So we are talking about something that is very, very distinct. And it says, Amar lo HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So God said to Aaron, Ata rotze l'arbot shalom ba'olam, your will is to bring peace to the world. Al yadcha yirbe shalom lemala. I'm going to make it that you're going to make peace also in the upper worlds. Harektoret asamim mesura biyadcha mikan va'ela. So the incense is given to you from now on and forever. What's the connection to the incense? So the incense had a very powerful blessing because the word for incense, the incense we're talking about in the temple, was called ketoret. And it's coming, as the commentator is saying, from the word ktua. Ktua means in Aramaic, kshua, connected. So because the incense has 11 spices in it, that are 10 sefirot and one extra, okay, contradicting, controlling the dark side. So the incense of the temple had the ability to connect all the sefirot as one and contradict all the darkness. So when everything becomes one, that's the energy of peace. Okay, how is that connected to our parsha today? Okay, how it's connected to our life? Now, just before that, we continue. Nadav Avihu, Hikdimu Bechaya Avihem, Nadav and Avihu, they brought the incense on the day of the dedication of the tabernacle. They were not supposed to do that. And the word is Hikdimu Bechaya Avihem. What does it mean, Hikdimu? They did it too early. If they just waited for their turn, they will be bringing the offering of the incense. They did not wait for their turn. Does that remind us something? Okay. It says in the Zohar that the dedication of the tabernacle was such a powerful, happy, glorious day that if not the story of the two sons of Aaron, that will have the ability to cleanse the whole thing of the golden calf. What was the whole thing of the golden calf? That the Israelite did not wait for Moses. He was late 6 hours. That's how they thought. If they waited 6 more hours, everything will look different. Does that remind us something? Oh, there's another midrash. If Adam and Eve waited 6 more hours for eating the fruit of the tree of knowledge, that will be the right thing to do. And that will be, everything will come into peace and completion. Do you see that element coming again and again? The two sons of Aaron, they were not wrong, they were just too early. And being too early is a big wrong, as you just learned, which means patience, the ability to wait for your time. Timing could sometimes be everything. And timing is connected to patience. And patience is connected to the ability for a person to endure the fact that I cannot have it now in order to have a bigger of it later on. Does that remind us about our attributes? What does it mean? Let me explain how it's connected to this parasha. So Moses was contemplating, thinking, Mi garam lahem taut zo? Who caused them that kind of a mistake? And he was in trouble. Okay, but it says, Vaydaber Hashem Moshe Chai Shmot Shnei Bnei Aaron, and God spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron. And what does it say? Bekorvatam, he said to him, Bekorvatam Lifnei Hashem V'yamotu. As they were, what's the word? Bekorvatam. It doesn't say Behakrivam, as they bringing the offering, but it says Bekorvatam, as they approached and got closer in front of God. Okay. We understand that the two sons of Aaron, they brought the incense, although it was not their job. However, they wanted so much to get close to God. They took the incense and they ran in. What was the result? The fire of God consumed them from inside, and they were burned from the inside, and their souls went out. By the way, nobody says that that's a sin, which is very weird. And Rabbi Azakluria explains that the two sons of Aaron, Nadav and Avihu, were the highest souls ever walked on earth. They were so high. They touched the glory of God, and they experienced it like nobody else. However, when they wanted to be part of it, they had to wait. They didn't realize that. Okay? So they had to come again. They had to come again, and they came again with what, says the Zohar, when Pinchas, 38 years later, died when he killed Cosbi and Zimri, when he sacrificed himself to save the nation. What happened in that moment? Nadav and Avihu came into Pinchas, revived him, and then Pinchas came back. Now he had three souls. That power brought something. That's what it says in Dari. How weird it sounds like. That power made Pinchas become a high priest by himself, and he lived forever. The Talmud says, Pinchas, this is Elijah. Pinchas never died. He became so godly that later on the people started to call him Eliyahu Hanavi, Elijah the prophet. And what happened to Elijah? He went up with a chariot of fire. And every time we have that ability to connect to consuming fire to something so powerful like the Seder night, like at the end of Shabbat, when so much light and you have to land into physicality. And you need to have this patience for the limitation of this physical world. Who comes to help? Elijah, the prophet. Patience, endurance. He's giving to us. And what does it say? When the Messiah is coming, Elijah will come to prepare the road and to give us peace. Ve'eshiv le'avot al banim ve'le'banim al avotam. He will bring the hearts of the fathers to the sons and the hearts of the sons to their fathers. That remind you something nowadays? That always in the last century, the children always think that the parents' generation, they have no idea what they're talking about, right? And the parents, they think the kids don't have any idea what they're talking about. It's like the gap of the generations, which is the biggest and most painful problem. So Pinchas is Elijah, and Elijah, Eliyahu Navi, is Nadav and Avihu. Confused? Let's see how it's connected to this week. So why is it now? I'll explain. The rest of the parasha is describing whatever is needed for us to know about Yom Kippur. We read this parasha as it is, including the first verse on Yom Kippur. And what is Yom Kippur about? Yom Kippur is about a day, a great day, an awesome day, a day in which the Creator is giving us so much light that that light has the ability to cleanse our hearts and souls like water cleanses the body. Vezarakti alechem mayim torim utaharetem. We read it many times in the prayers of Yom Kippur, and I will throw on you pure water and you will be purified. So what is Yom Kippur about? It's about this amazing, powerful light coming down at us, washing us from within and from without. So the power, the essence of Yom Kippur, what the sages are saying, Itzumo shel Yom Kippur mechaper. The essence of Yom Kippur atones, cleanses, purifies. That's why when you connect to that power of Yom Kippur, the day after, everything is fresh. You feel fresh, like you get a new beginning. A new beginning. Okay. Now, how is this connected to this week? Now, this week, Parashat Achrimot and Parashat Kedoshim, we read in Israel, these two parashot this Shabbat, outside of Israel. This week we read the Zriya Metzorah, because if you are outside of Israel, you're lagging 1 week behind. Not just this time, but this is to show you that sometimes you lag behind. You're always lagging behind if you're not connected directly to Israel and Jerusalem. But that's, you know, you have your tikkun if you live outside of Israel and you have to work on that. Maybe you'll have the merit to become an Israeli. However, but this is also the connection to the month of Iyar, and the month of Iyar is a very powerful month, because what the sages are saying, that the month of Iyar is full of light. First of all, Iyar means light, okay? The ruling planet is Noga, Venus. Hebrew, in Hebrew, Noga means glamour, light. The biblical original name of the month of Iyar in the Book of Kings is Yerach Ziv. Ziv means shining light, okay? And the main date on this day, on this month, is the celebration of the completion of the Zohar and the Hilulah of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, the author of the Zohar, and it's called Lag BaOmer. And Zohar means also splendor and light. So this is a month full of light. But isn't that the time of the Omer? And don't we have some limitations in the Omer? We cannot make celebrations like weddings and like big celebrations, except from Lag BaOmer. You can't just make big celebration on this month. So what is there in this? You know, it sounds like an oxymoron. A month that is so full of so much light, on the other hand, you have to be careful. You have to be careful. No contradiction. I'll prove it to you. First of all, the connection of these two parashot to the month of Iyar are obvious if you know Kabbalah. If you know Kabbalah, you read in the book of Sefer Yetzirah, the book of formation, that is related to Abraham the patriarch, and he says over there that the month of Iyar has been created, generated, formed, that's a word, to form, was formed from the letter Vav. Okay? And the planet Venus has been formed by the letter Pei. Okay? So the two letters that are controlling, ruling this month of Iyar, according to Sefer Yetzirah of Avraham Avinu, and that's the two letters to meditate on every day if you want to be in tune to this month, are the letters Pei and Vav. Pei, Venus, Vav, that's Iyar, Taurus, okay? But if you know Kabbalah, you know that Pei Vav is very powerful. Pei Vav, for whoever knows, Kabbalah Pei Vav is a number. 86. What is 86? Elohim. The name of God that represents the subjective, the experience of judgment. Did we say this is the month of light? Noga, Iyar, Zohar, Ziv, all of these words, like almost all the synonyms for light in Hebrew, are connected to this month. Oh, yes. If it's a month that is so full of light, so full of light, what happened when the two sons of Aaron connected to too much light? They were burned. Which means when there's such high voltage, you have to be careful. Why? Because a high voltage can burn you up, can burn you down, or burn you in. What happened to the two sons of Aaron? Too much light without the right precautions is a problem. I'll give you an example. Let's say you're invited for a special interview to the palace of the king, a big king. I'm not talking about Elizabeth, Queen Elizabeth, a real king, like the king of once upon a time when they, like King David, okay? Somebody like a king like this, okay? So you're coming into the palace, you're so excited because you got a personal letter from the king's secretary that you invited for a scene with the king, right? And you come in, and before you come in, you're going to come into the palace. Not everybody's invited to the palace. And you're going to have a session, you know, one-on-one with the king. So on one hand, you're really, really excited. On the other hand, you're kind of afraid. I don't know how to behave in the king's palace. I'm afraid maybe I'm going to say something wrong and then, you know, I can be hanged. I can be executed because of saying something wrong in the presence of the king or in the palace of the king. Now, how do I know what to do? So you really want to learn what are the rules when you're in the king's presence. What are the rules when you're in the king's palace? Why? Because this is so powerful over there, you really have to be careful. Okay? Give you another example. You build a home and you want to connect your home to the network of the grid of electricity. The new house to the grid, you have to prove to the engineers of the electric company that your house is being wired exactly by code. Why? Because the electric company will do everything possible to get the line, the grid to your doorstep. However, from that moment on, it's your responsibility not to abuse the power you've been given to. Because if you don't connect to it properly, that power can burn your house down, right? So what do? You know that when you connect it to high voltage power, you need to really be careful because it's not a children's game. Okay. The month of Iyal that we are just started this today is the month of light. But at the same time, we have to remember that we just celebrated 2 weeks ago Pesach. It's only 2 weeks ago, like eons past. What happened on Pesach? We got freedom. But freedom is about the ability of a person to grow up, to take responsibility, to look inside, to hold on, to have patience, to have the power to resist the desire to have it all right now and to burn everything down. That's being grown up. That's being a free human being. A free human being doesn't mean that everything is permissible, that everything is okay, that if it's enjoyable, then it's great. Everything that is tasty is good for us. Yes, we all know it's not, right? Everything that makes us happy will make us happy forever. A lot of things makes us happy for just a short little gratification, and then it can get us miserable for a long time. The ability to be a grown-up, to be a real grown-up, to really be a real free person. We got it on the night of Pesach. That's how we got out of Egypt. But it was gone. And we get it step by step, in little steps, every day of the 49 days of the Omer. 2 weeks of Nisan, 6 days in Sivan, Gemini, and a whole month of Iyal. So the enlightenment of becoming a grown-up, which means being responsible for your connection to the Creator every moment, is being developed mostly in the month of Iyal. This is the month of full projection of light. And you know, Iyal is also, if you permutate the letters Iyal, you get Yare. And Yare means awe, having awe. What is awe? You coming to the house of the king that invited you. You know the king invited you because he loves you. You know, he treasures you, he wants to give you everything. But you know that if you don't know how to behave, you can mess it all up. In the presence of God in Yom Kippur. On one hand, God says, I'm throwing on you pure water and you'll be pure, purified. On one hand. On the other hand, you have to repent. You have to be fasting. Not eating, not drinking, not going around with leather shoes. There's all kinds of stuff that you have to stay away with. As you know, when you're dealing with high voltage electricity, there are many things you have to give up. Why should I give it up? Oh, it can kill you. Why? It's too powerful. Oh, that's awesome. Yes. Ah is the L. Ah is a combination of, on one hand, amazing love. And by the way, what's the planet again for the month of Iyar? Noga, Venus. And what is Venus? The planet of love, right? So it's all about love. But, you know, a lot of people think that love is about doing whatever. If the universe loves me, If you love me, you should let me do whatever I feel like. Who speaks like this? Children, right? You want to grow up? Then you learn that love, that's by the way, when you talk about this love, that everything is permissible because everybody's love. This love is called to fall in love. Have you ever wondered why it says to fall in love? If it's real love and love is so godly, to be exalted in love. Because that childish love is always falling. It's always falling. When you're really in love with another person, I'm not talking about just romantic love, any kind of love, you also have, in the same time you love them, you have a responsibility to be careful and not to hurt them. To be careful and to know that they're humans and not to expect too much of them, so you don't go into this tantrum when they don't give you whatever you expected them to give you. Love is about responsibility. Love is about hard work, because loving another person is a hard work of being patient, not being complaining all the time. You know, but I wanted you to give me this and you gave me a little bit different. Love is not going into tantrum. Mom, if you love me, you should have given me the present I really wanted. Your child, your baby. Yeah, your mom loves you, but that's what she could give you. You should say, thank you, mom, for taking care of me, right? Same thing with your spouse, your children, anyone you claim that you love. It's not about demanding. It's about being aware that this is a very precious thing and it can fall apart any second. Do you know why in a Jewish wedding we break a glass in the end of the wedding? Because when you break a glass, putting it back together, that's almost impossible. What do we say at the same time? We say, if I forget you, Jerusalem, why? Why was Jerusalem destroyed? Because of hatred for no reason. And you know what? There's no hatred for a reason. Hatred is poison. Love is healing. But not kind of love that falling in love. You know, I love what you are going to give me. That's not love. Love is Ahava, and Ahava, numerical value, Gematria, is 13. 13 is one outside the box. 13 is also Echad, one. Aleph is one. Chet, of the word Echad, is 8. Dalet is 4, together 13. Ahava, love, is about the ability to be there for somebody else, even though it's not that comfortable. That's love. When a mother loves her child, she doesn't care when it's not comfortable to get up in the middle of the night to give him food or to sit with him because he has fever. That's love. She doesn't say like, okay, you know, enough is enough. Two nights I didn't sleep. Now you go to the street. She tells the baby that. Does she? That's love. Love is the ability to be there and to love and to care, even though it's not that comfortable. The month of Iyar is the month of healing. And the only power of healing is the same as on Yom Kippur. It is divine love coming from above, that if you abuse it, it becomes judgment. That's the 86, the Peivav. On the other hand, that could be awesome love that heals, because the love that heals, the love that you take responsibility for, this is what Parashat Achrayimot is about. It's about the two sons of Aaron. They got too close to God. They were burnt. We have to learn that love is not just coming and jumping and hugging and enjoying. Love is about something that two sons of Aaron did not do. They were in love, but they forgot awe. Awe means that I love, but I'm at the same time aware not to mess it up. So the month of Iyar is a month of healing. How do we know? So we learn that it says in the book of Exodus, after the splitting of the Red Sea, that there was a test, another test after the splitting of the Red Sea. Everybody was upset, and then God made the water sweet, not bitter. And then he says, if you follow the rules I'm giving you, what do you mean follow the rules? That's when you want to be on the grid, you have to follow the code. You have to follow the rules. And if something in the house goes on fire because you didn't follow the rules, he cannot sue the electric company. It's not their problem. They gave you the supply of all that energy. The problem is you did not handle that energy with awe. What do you mean with awe? Thankfulness, love, excitement, and being careful. What does it mean being careful? Not to abuse that awesome power. So the whole of the parasha is about Yom Kippur. It's about the cleansing. And what about Elijah? We know that healing, that love is about healing. Love is about healing. Now, how do you know that this is connected to Parashat Tachrimot and Kedoshim? And you know, love others as you love yourself. Where is it? In Parashat Kedoshim. And the parasha is starting Kedoshim Tiyu. And a lot of people read it as, you should be holy. Can you force somebody to be holy? You have to want it. You have to love it. You have to be excited about it. No, it doesn't say Kedoshim Heyu as an order. It says Kedoshim Tiyu as a promise. As a promise. You follow the rules that I created. Sooner or later, you will become holy. And what did we explain what has been holy? With a WH. You become a whole. You will be able to be loving and excited. At the same time, to be in awe and careful about not to mess up the love and the chesed and the positivity. This is what this week is about. It's about so much power of love and positivity, and that's why our tikkun in this month, and especially this week, is very much into loving. The same way you love a child, the same way you love somebody dear, it's the love that is coming down to earth that we have to tap into. This is why the month of Taurus is a month of love. How come? So, first of all, Taurus in Hebrew is Shor. Shor is the same numerical value. Shin is 300. Vav is 6. Resh is 200. Altogether, 506. 506, says Rabbi Zakaria, is the numerical value of unconditional love. Ahavat Chinam. Okay? Now, you haven't still some doubt? If you read in the old-fashioned Chumashim, Torah books, at the end of every parasha, there's a summary of how many verses in the parasha, and there's a code word. So, Parashat HaChaimot is 80 psukim. What is 80? In Hebrew, you don't use the digits of the numbers we're using. Usually for numbers. He use Hebrew because Hebrew letters are numbers. So it says in the Chumash, the letter Pei. Pei is 80. What did we say Pei is? Pei is the letter that formed the power of planet Noga, Venus. That's Pei. And Kedoshim, which is being read mostly together with the Chaimot, it says in the end of Parashat Kedoshim, 64 verses. How do you write 64 in Hebrew? Samech Dalet. Samech Dalet is nothing that we know about, but there's a code word. And what's the code word? Ve Noga. Ve is Vav. Vav, it says in Sefer Yetzirah, is Taurus. Noga is the planet, Venus. So together, Ve Noga is 64. So you have in the numbers of the verses that we read this in Israel, this Shabbat, 80 and 64, which is 144, which is, I don't know, this is 12 point times 12, but I don't know what does it mean. But it is about one thing. It means It means it covers everyone. How many signs of the zodiac are there? 12. How many types of people? 12. Just 12? Oh, you have in every sign, you have 12 rising signs. So how many are together? 144. When you love every person the way they are, and you have the patience to let them grow and find themselves, you have the connection to Venus, which is real unconditional love and a lot of light. And when you have that light, which is the light of Elijah, what is the light of Elijah? It's the ability to have cleansing. And when do you have cleansing? When on one hand you allow chesed, love, into you, and on the other hand, you realize that you have to be careful on dealing with that energy you're getting. And because love is not just about enjoying, it's also about enjoying resisting the temptation to lose patience. To, you know, I want to feel great right now. I don't want to wait. And that's all about growing up. So the healing power of this parashot, Achrei Mot and Kedushim, is the healing power of Yom Kippur and unconditional love. It's the healing power that allows us to heal. And that's why this is the month of healing. When we allow that to come in, that is what healing is about. That is what being a grown-up is about. A real grown-up is somebody who's one hand very happy and appreciative about everything he's got. On the other hand, he knows how to deal with high voltage experiences, enjoy it, and at the same time, take full responsibility in holding him or herself in a place that it's my responsibility. And I cannot approach the bench, the creator, too fast. Otherwise, I can blow it all. Let's read what the Zohar says about that. And the Zohar says, Rabbi Yitzchak Patach, Rabbi Yitzchak opened and said, I'm reading in verse number 2 in the Zohar Perusha Sulam of Rav Ashlag. Rabbi Yitzchak opened and said, and he's quoting Psalms chapter 2. And it says, Yivdu et Hashem v'yira, you should walk the work of God with awe, in Hebrew, ira, or reverse of the letters, yare, yar, okay? Yivdu et Hashem v'yira, do the work of God with ira, with awe, v'gilu v'irada, and you should rejoice with a tremor. And then it says in another place, and that is Psalms 100, Yivdu et Hashem v'simcha, do the work of God with happiness, bo lefana birnana, come to him, with approach him with joy, joyous singing and dancing. So it's like, what is it? Should it be with awe or the happiness, rejoicing, tremor? Mikraot Elu Sotrim says that these verses, they contradict each other. One speaks about the awe, the fear, and one speaks about happiness and being glad and rejoice. Shekhan Omer, here it speaks about awe and tremor, and the other one, happiness and rejoicing. Omeshiv Elakach Lamadnu. However, he says we learn. Yivdu et Hashem v'yira, bechol avoda shirotze adam lavod lifnei ribono. In every work that is inviting the light of God into this work, batchila tzach yira. In the beginning, you need awe. You have to. Okay? Liro mipanav. Why? As we said, when you connect your house to the grid, that has to be with total responsibility. For no, you know, just, you know, we don't do it exactly by code. Just, no, nobody will see that. Nobody? the house can go on fire. Things like that do happen. You have to be really in total responsibility that you can mess the whole thing up if you don't really follow the rules. And that's why, you know, there's a Zohar saying in the entrance, in the introduction to the Zohar, that after Rabbi Shimon left his cave, the cave that he was there for 13 years, he you know, 13 years sitting in the cave, he had a lot of skin issues. Okay, so he goes to Tiberias, to the hot springs of Tiberias to heal himself. And he meets over there Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, his father-in-law. Rabbi Pinchas sees Rabbi Shimon with all of his skin issues. And he says, "Oi, oi, that I saw you this way." And Rabbi Shimon says, "I'm so happy that you saw me this way, because if you was not, you didn't see me like this way, I wouldn't be this way." Which means, you know, there was a cost in the skin disease that I was in a cave for 13 years, but if I was not in a cave for 13 years, I wouldn't be Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. I wouldn't be able to bring the Zohar to the world. And then he says, before going to the springs, I have to teach you the 14 most important principles in the whole Torah, and it's all hidden in the first verses of Genesis. And it starts with Bereshit, the first word in the Torah. And Bereshit, if you look in the letters of Bereshit, you will find the letters of Aleph, Yud, Resh, Iyar, and Yare, having R. Reshit Chokhmah, Yirat Hashem. The beginning of wisdom is R. Then it says Reshit Da'at. Reshit Da'at, Yirat Hashem. It's also the beginning of Da'at, not just Chokhmah. And Rabbi Shimon is asking, is it the beginning of Da'at or the beginning of Chokhmah? And the Zohar says, Rabbi Shimon says, every level you want to tap into, every level of power you want to tap, you have to start with awe. There's a difference between awe and fear. Little children, they are afraid. Fear makes you small. And when you're small, you cannot love because your heart shrinks. You cannot take responsibility because you feel weak, right? Awe is about enlarging your ability to take responsibility, and awe and love can live together, not fear and love. Awe and love, as we just said, if you really love somebody, you go on your toes not to hurt them because you take responsibility, because you know you can mess it up because this is sensitive. Because love is a very precious thing, and every precious thing you have to cover it and treasure it. Okay? So every work that a person wants to do that is connected to the Creator, you need awe. And the awe gives you the ability to connect a little bit of fear, but it's a healthy fear. Fear of taking responsibility. Not fear from the responsibility, but the fear that makes you careful, says Rabbi Shimon over there. And if you have the awe, because of that awe, says the Zohar, Yizkeh l'achar kach lasot besimcha mitzvat haTorah. The moment you have that awe, you'll be really careful not to mess it up. When you know the boundaries, when you have the judgment, you know how to activate the judgment, you know where it is okay and when it's not okay, you can afford yourself have real happiness. Not a stupid happiness, careless happiness that always comes down like falling in love. Brings you down into tears, into pain, into despair. No, this is the real spiritual excitement and happiness, that what is more is more. The more you're happy, the more certainty you have, the more self-esteem you have, the more you can be capable of being happy, and you can grow with that happiness more and more and more. This is the wisdom of this parasha. This is the wisdom of this month. And that's why it says also in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 10. Ma Hashem Elokecha Shoev Mimach. What is that God wants from you? Kim Lira? Ah. Ah is the love that is combined with carefulness. It's not fear. It's taking responsibility. The same way I can do everything great, I can also, it depends on me, I can make mistakes, and I really want to be responsible for that. Shal yada yizkeh l'kol. By this, you have the merit to win everything. Okay, so there's a lot more to it, but I think you can go on and reading the next verses in the Torah, and also in Love Others as You Love Yourself, in the Sefer Kedoshim, about being holy is about, again, the mixture of love, awareness, being careful, not to be because you're afraid, but because you know that's the job. And to become a professional, you need awe. You know the power, you know the limits. Thank you so much.
Okay.
And Chodesh Tov.
Thank you.